On a small group of islands east of New Zealand lives a special little bird, the Chatham Island black robin. Today, there are well over 200, but in the 1980s, only 5 existed. And of those, only one was a fertile female. This is the most extreme genetic bottleneck a population can experience. The technical way of saying the population declined dramatically and then recovered from a few individuals. And every robin today is more closely related than siblings. Remarkably, the only major genetic issue faced because of this was a gene that caused the birds to lay eggs on the edge of their nests, where, unless a person pushed the egg into the middle, it would not survive. Because conservationists chose to protect all eggs initially, this gene spread to around 50% of the population. Ultimately, they had to stop saving every egg, and now this gene is very rare as any with it don't produce offspring, being unfit. For most species, however, such a population reduction would have led to extinction. Species on small islands are unique, because such bottlenecks happen due to the initial foundation of the population from a few individuals blown to its shores, and random chance events causing populations to dwindle. So, invariably, they will breed with relatives. And to survive for very long, all deleterious traits have to be bred out. Getting some deleterious trait is one of the primary reasons to outbreed, which means to not breed with relatives, but outbreeding also has the benefit of allowing for genetic diversity, something these robins lack. Protecting genetic diversity is becoming a more and more important part of modern conservation efforts. Genetic diversity is critical for helping a species survive far into the future, as the more diverse a population is, the higher chance when faced with change, some individuals will have a mutation advantageous to the new situation, making them more fit and allow the species to evolve into the future. That is what protecting genetic diversity is all about, ensuring a species can evolve. What most people know about evolution is that Charles Darwin figured out that species change over time because of selection pressures in their environment that make some individuals more or less fit, which is not necessarily who is the strongest, but who makes the most offspring. This theory is called natural selection. It is pretty simple. Take, for example, the famed white sand dunes of New Mexico. These gypsum dunes make anything dark stand out. So, over time, predators have eaten all of the darker colored members of the species here, and those that were the lightest rarely were predated on, driving the population, which is what is actually evolving, to be very light. Selection can only work on existing phenotypes and genotypes, the physical appearance and genetic makeup respectively, not those that don't yet exist. Really, when discussing evolution, natural selection should just be called selection, as sometimes the selection pressures can be very unnatural. As humans change the planet, species must also change, and those without advantageous genes circulating in their population will go extinct as the population cannot adapt to the new environment. One of the most famous cases of this was the extinction event in Africa's Lake Victoria after Nile perch were introduced. They devoured native cichlid fish, driving some to extinction with this new selection pressure. Certain kinds of cichlids were more affected. The two most negatively impacted groups were the predatory piscivores and the detritivores. Detritivores kept the whole lake in balance, and their sudden disappearance led to an increase in rotting organic material that caused the lake to eutrophy, meaning the deeper parts of the lake are devoid of oxygen and more floating organic material decreased visibility, both of which added new selection pressures. Cichlids still living in the lake, like this Pundamilia nairi, are quite different from their ancestors living just a century ago. They have larger eyes to see in the murkier waters, and their gills are larger to allow them to breathe less oxygenated water. The older phenotype was ill-suited to the changing lake, but the population contained enough diversity that some individuals did very well, driving the whole population in this new direction. Unfortunately, not every cichlid in the lake was this lucky. Evolution is a game of catch-up, with populations working as hard as they can to adapt to the latest change in the ecosystem, trying not to slide into extinction. Protecting species into the future requires they have the diversity to have potentially advantageous phenotypes and genotypes circulating in their population, so that the population can survive in the face of major change. Protecting genetic diversity, though, goes beyond selection. Selection is not evolution, only one driver, one of four. There is also mutation, migration, and drift. Mutations are responsible for genetic diversity and potential advantageous and deleterious traits that are then selected upon. Migration shows another way of bringing genetic diversity into a population. Have individuals from other populations come in and introduce their genes. Conservationists did this with the Florida panther, a special subspecies of mountain lion that had become inbred and many deleterious genes were being expressed. So, mountain lions from Texas were released and these new genes helped resolve these genetic issues, and the cats still roam the wilds of Florida today. Finally comes genetic drift, which is of particular interest to conservation. It deals with how genes from parents are distributed into their offspring. Only some of the genetic material of any one parent makes it into their offspring, usually around 50%. This means there is a probability a particular gene may or may not be in the offspring. This is not a huge issue in large populations, but in small populations of endangered species, this can be devastating. What happens is by chance, genes are passed on or not, and in such a small population, certain traits can quickly become fixed. That is, every member of the population has the trait. And because it is random chance, it doesn't matter if it makes individuals in the population fitter or not. In fact, drift can work against selection, leading to extinction. The larger the population, the less likely fixation becomes. And then selection can drive how common traits are, not chance. Well, I hope I explained how understanding evolution and its drivers is really important to conservation biology. This video is part of an ongoing Fundamentals of Conservation Biology series, with a new episode coming out each and every month. So if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up. Like a predator, select the subscribe button that isn't blended in, and don't forget to ring the bell so you can be notified when the next video in this series comes out. Thank you for watching, I really appreciate it. Bye.